We thank you, Almighty God, that your name is Yahweh. Father, and you are worthy to be praised. We thank you, God, that you are an incredible God. We thank you, Lord, that when we knock, you open the door. We thank you, Lord, when we call, you answer us, Almighty God. And Father, this morning we want to just, Lord, surrender all to you. Father, we decree and declare, Father, that this is your house. Father, come and dwell in the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth. Father, I continue to hide myself behind the rock of ages, Almighty God, for you alone are worthy. Father, I pray that your people will not see me, but they will hear you in the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth. Father, your word is already blessed. So, Father, I take myself out of the way, Lord, and say, you be glorified, be magnified and exalted. In Jesus' name we pray. If the church agrees, let me hear you say amen. Amen. Come on, say amen, amen, amen. You may take your seats. Hallelujah, hallelujah. You may take your seats. I want to say good morning again to each and every one of you. I thank God again for you. Thank you for joining us this morning. We welcome Facebook as they're online with us. And I pray that this word will truly minister to your hearts. Hallelujah, hallelujah. I'm going to jump right into it. Now, the scripture was already read from Exodus chapter 3, from verse 7 to verse 10. And it opens up so many questions when you read that scripture. And many of us should probably know the story of the Israelites and how the Israelites were slaves in Egypt. But though they were slaves in Egypt, the Bible tells us that they were God's chosen people. Now that sounds contradictory, but that's what it was, right? They were God's chosen people, yet they were slaves in Egypt. So God then, he spoke to Moses where? From a burning bush. And Moses was in the wilderness before that. You need to understand where Moses was. He was in the wilderness after running from Egypt, right, for the fear of his life. Now, the same story tells us that Pharaoh's heart, and Pharaoh was the one that was in charge of the Egyptians. And the Bible tells us that Pharaoh's heart was hardened towards God and towards the people of God. Amen. Let me know if you're following me. The Bible continues to tell us that God decided that he was going to send some plagues. Because Pharaoh's heart was hardened, because Pharaoh refused to let the children of God go. So God sent some plagues on the Egyptians. And the final plague was the killing of the firstborn. If you have any kids, can you imagine? Can you imagine losing your firstborn? But this happened because the Egyptians refused. They refused, Pharaoh in particular, he refused to do what? To submit and surrender to God. Now, as I read this story, there are some things that jumped out at me, which I would love to share with you this morning. However, my prayer for you is that you will inspect your own lives. Don't just look on Pharaoh and the Israelites, but inspect our lives and see where we find what is called parallels. Amen? Now, I've shared many times how I used to live a double standard life in my early days of my walk with the Lord. And I need you to understand, I don't share it, Sister Amavi, because I'm proud of it. Okay? That's not the reason why I share it over and over. It's not because I'm proud. It's because I believe that my life is a testimony of God's grace. It's a testimony of God's grace. It is also the workings of the true transformation when we say yes to God. I share it hoping that we will not decide to give up on people, but we should help them to get to their God-given what? To get to their God-given destiny. One of the churches understanding me. Listen, God doesn't want us to walk in disobedience, church. God does not want us to walk in disobedience. The Bible says, and be not conformed to this world, but be he what? Transformed by the renewing of your mind, that you may what? Prove what is good and acceptable. Amen? What is good and acceptable and perfect will of God. This battery is dying. It means it's not plugged in. It's not plugged in. I want to start by inviting us to go to 2 Corinthians chapter 5. 2 Corinthians, come on, turn your Bibles with me to 2 Corinthians chapter 5. And we're going to read verse 16 and 17. Hallelujah. Well-known scripture. 2 Corinthians, and you're going to be turning to various scriptures with me this morning. Hallelujah. So 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 16 to 17, it says, so from now on, we regard no one from a worldly point of view. Though we once regarded Christ in this way, we do so no longer. Listen to verse 17. Therefore, if any man or anyone is in Christ, he's a what? New creature. The old has what? Church, you need to understand. The old has passed away, but the new is come. Why did I start with that? I start with that because I want us to understand, Church of the Living God, that we are not called to look back on what we had. We are not called to look back on the things we have or had or who we were. That's not what we are called to do. We are children of God, and now we are what? New creatures. Listen, another scripture tells us, 1 Corinthians chapter 13, verse 11. When I was a child, I spoke and thought and reasoned as a child. But when I grew up, I did what? Put away childish things. Church, the Israelites were rescued by Yahweh Nissi. The Israelites were rescued by Jehovah Nissi. What does Jehovah Nissi mean? The Lord is my banner. That's who rescued the Israelites. Now, the Israelites, as per scripture, they were made slaves. I remember that. Exodus 1, verse 11, it says, so the Egyptians made the Israelites their slaves. They appointed brutal slave drivers over them, hoping to wear them down with crushing labor. They forced them to build cities of Python and Rameses as supply centers for the king. Church of God, not only were the Israelites slaves, but they were constantly abused. I'm talking to children of God. I'm talking to chosen people of God. They were constantly abused. Verse 13 said, so the Egyptians worked the children of Israel without mercy. I'm just reading scripture. They made their lives bitter, forcing them to mix mortar and make bricks and do all the works in the fields. They were ruthless, as per scripture, in all their demands. Church, the Israelites were not treated well in Egypt. They were under immense pressure. Also, they were in poverty. They were in a state of nothingness. Their lives had no meaning. They went through abuse after abuse. You see, many of us That's what we encountered in the world before. Now, some of you will say, well, I've never been abused. But I beg to disagree with you. Let me help you. The life of drinking, partying, sexual immorality, spirit of rage, and many more. These things come from people who are running from something. These things are manifested from people who are running from something, or running from God, or running from themselves. Sometimes these things come from people who are running from their families. Or sometimes we are trying to fit into a particular friendship. Have you ever been there? Where you want to be with this type of people, so you do the things they do, but you know it's not correct. Church of God, can I tell you that the things we went through did not just come out of space. They had a root cause. They had a root cause. Now, ladies and gentlemen, I want you to understand something. Do not underestimate the power Satan has. I'm going to repeat that. Do not underestimate the power Satan has. But I can't end there. Never elevate his power either. You see, we sometimes think that, Satan has no power. Listen, I beg to differ. He has power. The important thing for you to understand is that the power that you possess as a child of God is greater than the power that Satan has. And that's why you have to understand that no weapon that is formed against you shall prosper. Why? Because your power is greater than the power of your enemy. But sometimes we are not walking in our power. Church, the point that I want to make is the devil is always at work. Matter of fact, the Bible tells us he seeks to what? To devour and to destroy you and I. That's him. Jump with me to Exodus 2 and verse 23 to 25. Listen to this. Years passed. Exodus chapter 2, verse 23 to 25. Years passed. And the king of Egypt died, but the Israelites continued to groan under their burden of slavery. They cried out for help, and their cry rose up to who? To God. The Bible tells us, verse 24, that God heard their groanings, and he remembered what? His covenant promise to Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. You know what God did? He looked down on the people of Israel and knew that it was time to act. Church, can I tell you, in time of distress, the children of Israel cried out to the one they knew would bring hope. They cried out to the one they knew would bring change. They cried out to the one they knew would bring transformation. They cried out to the one they knew would bring newness. They cried out to the one they knew will bring deliverance, will bring healing, will bring breakthrough, will bring restoration. Like many of us, we have cried out for a second chance as well. And I thank God that Jesus responded to our cry. Hebrews chapter 4 verse 15 says, "For we have not a high priest which cannot be touched," I wish I had a church, "which cannot be touched with the feeling of our infirmities, but was in all points tempted as we are, yet without sin." That's the God that we serve. See, church, the Lord responds to our cry of desperation. He responds. What's the song that Pastor Cash raised? Anybody remember it? Every time I call, he what? Answers. Every time I knock, he what? Opens the door. The Lord responds also when we seek after him. Where do we get that? We get that from Jeremiah 23, verse 11. It says, "And he shall seek me and find me when you shall search with me with part of your heart. Oh, Jesus. When you can search with me with just with your tithes. When you can search with me with just when you pray. No, the Bible says when you search for me with what? All your heart. So the question I have for us is, why are we only seeking God with part of us? Why is it that we're only seeking God with a part of us and not all of our heart? Church, what situation are you faced with that you're not sure about or you're not sure what to do? I want to help you with something. Psalm 34, verse 18 to 20. Listen keenly to what it says. The Lord is close to the broken heart. This is Bible. That's all I'm reading. All I'm reading is Bible. The Lord is close to what? The broken. Listen to this. He rescues those whose spirits are crushed. I wonder if I'm talking to anybody in this place. The righteous person faces many troubles, but the Lord comes to the rescue each time. Oh, Jesus. I feel like Pastor Cash and I came together, but I didn't know the song that she was about to worship with this morning. But I need you to understand this is Bible. Verse 20 says, for the Lord protects the bones of the righteous. Church, the bones, not your flesh, the bones. In other words, he goes past your outer and goes deep inside of you, and he protects the bones of the righteous. And the Bible says not one of them is broken. As I wrote this last night, the Lord said to me, we should pause. I'm going to invite you all to stand, please. And I'm going to give you an instruction. Now, you do not have to do this. Let me be clear. You do not have to do it. This is your choice. Listen to the instruction. Whatever your current situation is, that you do not see a breakthrough, I want you to come and leave it right here. Let me go again. Whatever, or if you have a situation and you do not see a breakthrough, all I want you to do is to come, bring it here, talk to the Lord, leave it there, and then you can go back to your seat. Because we need to understand that the Bible said that the Lord is close to the brokenhearted. There are things that we are going through, and we don't even see how we're going to get over it. But God says to tell you this morning, don't look back, just bring it at the altar. Bring it at the altar. Once you bring it at the altar and you release it, you can go and take your seats. Rikasoto romondirida baba satai. Rishikanda rabababa siketo robo satai. Father, as we bring our concerns, as we bring our pains, as we bring our troubles, Father, as we bring our concerns, as we bring, Father, these things, God, that have us bound at the altar this morning, God, we lay them and we leave them at the altar. If you're online, create your own altar. Create your own altar. It doesn't need to be long. You just need to come and say it before God and leave it there. Father, we thank you. We thank you for the things that we have left at the altar. We thank you, God, for the things that we have left at the altar. We thank you, God, that we are set free. We thank you, God, that we are renewed. We are revived. Oh, I wish I had a church who will understand what God is doing in this place this morning. Father, we let it go. We let it go. We let it go. Father, your word says the Lord is close to the brokenhearted. He rescues those of us whose spirits are crushed. Father, as we stand here, God, there are those, Lord, who their spirits are crushed this morning. But Father, your word says the righteous person, we may face many troubles, but the Lord comes to our rescue. If you have received your deliverance, I just want you to say amen.
Amen.
I can't receive your deliverance for you. I receive my deliverance. If you have received your deliverance, just believe and just say amen. Hallelujah. You may take your seats. Hallelujah. You have to understand that the Bible continues and the Bible says, come all ye that are what? Burdened and heaven laden, and I will give you what? Rest. That's scripture. So church, watch this. Watch this. God delivered the children of Israel out of bondage. Amen? He delivered them out of slavery. Now you have to follow me here. They left Egypt. Terror. They left Egypt and they were heading through the wilderness towards the promised land. Somebody missed it. Somebody missed it. Let me help you. They left Egypt, which was slavery. But to get Luigi to the destination, which is the promised land, they had to go through what? The wilderness. Oh, you need to understand something, church of God. In order for you to get to the door, you have to walk through the middle right here. In order for you to get to what God says, you have to walk through some difficult times. You have to walk through some situations that will rock you, oh mighty God. But even when it rocks you, you have to what? You have to remain the course. Because it was Yahweh Nissi, Jehovah Nissi, because he was their what? Banner. I'm not sure if you got it. If this is my banner, it covers me. So as I walk over, I'm covered. Jesus, as you walk through your situation, as you walk through your circumstance, God says to tell you, you are covered. What are you covered by? You're covered by the blood of Jesus. You're almighty God. And that's why we have to worship him in season and out of season. In our happy moments, we have to worship him. In our difficult moments, we have to worship him. When things are not going well, we have to worship him. The Israelites, to get to the promised land, they had to go through the wilderness. Church, in the wilderness, at times in the scripture, there was no water, Amavi. Oh, Jesus. I'm not sure if the church gets it, Katie. In the wilderness, sometimes there was no food. In the wilderness, sometimes there was a wind that blew them away. In the wilderness, sometimes there was nothing to hold on to. But God says, I have a promised land with milk and honey. But the only way you're going to get there, you have to go through the wilderness. You have to go through the wilderness. What is it that you are going through? And you don't understand. Oh, Jesus, all you're doing is going through it. Church, I'm a Pauletta. Oh, God, I wish I understand. Katie, you're a teacher. Understand this. Through means you don't stop. Through means you don't stop in the middle. Oh, God. When you're going through something, Luigi, if you stop, you're going to stay in the situation, my God. But some of us, we stop in the middle and we complain like the Israelites. Some of us, you know what we do? We're in the middle of it and we look back to Egypt. I wonder if I have a church that's understanding me this morning. Because I know we haven't reached the promised land yet, John. And I understand that situation seems hard. I understand that things are not working the way we want. But this is not the place to stop. And it's not time to look back. It's time to move forward. Because, oh, gee, thank you. Because, listen, maybe physically you're hungry inside here now. Follow me. Maybe you're hungry.
But when you go through, Jesus, Hernandez, do me a favor. Stand up for a second. Go to that door. Go to that door. Close it. Close it. Everybody look at the door. No. Pull the door up. Pull them. No, right there. Right there. That's the door. Pull it in. Pull it in. Okay, pull the other one in. Right there. Pull the other. It's two sides. Church, you need to get me. You need to get me. Stay right there. Hold the door. Hold the door. We're hungry. Physically, you may be hungry. But guess what? Where's the food? The food is on the other side of the door. The only way you're going to be filled, you have to go through the door. Oh, Jesus. Church, I wonder if we understand what I'm saying. Oh, God, listen, you want water. The only way you're going to get water, you have to go through the door. Oh, Jesus, your breakthrough, church of God, kingdom builders, your breakthrough is not on this mighty God. Your breakthrough is not on this side. Your breakthrough is on the other side. But to get to there, you have to pass these chairs. And then you come to a door that seems closed. But can I tell you something? I know a God. I know a God. Open the door. That can open the door. I know a God that can open the door wide. And when he opens the door, no man can shut it. Recognize something. You can come to your seat. That door remains open. Church, look at it. That door remains open. Oh, Jesus. The only way it closes is if John or one of us gets up and close it. Almighty God. But God says, when I... I'm away from my notes. God says, when I open the door, no man can shut it. What is it that we're struggling with? Could it be because we have stopped in the wilderness? Could it be because, like the children of Israel, Kiba, we're still looking back at Egypt? Egypt was slavery. Egypt was slavery. And God said, I'm taking you from slavery. And I'm bringing you to a land of milk and honey. But the only way you're going to get there, you have to go through the wilderness. You have to go through trials. You have to go through heartaches. You have to go through circumstances that God, Amavi, God, I don't understand why. Have you ever asked God, why me? Oh, Jesus, you guys are holy. You have never asked God that. Oh, God, the amount of time I'm like, God, why me? I'm like, God, why not that person? Because they seem to know a little more than me. But can I tell you, oh, Jesus, the Bible says his grace is sufficient. Mighty God. The Bible says he has put a special grace on you. You can go through it. But as you go through it, you have to keep focused. Church, don't miss it. You have to go through it. You can't stop in the middle. You have to go through it. I'm here to tell somebody that the wilderness is not your destination. The wilderness is not your destination. The wilderness is your pathway. Oh, Jesus. But God, why didn't you not give me a different pathway or help me in this place? Because when you go through the heartaches along the way, you're going to find a Mika that needs help. You don't understand. You rather walk this way, but you walk here because God puts you here so you can help her. Why? Because what she's going through here, you experience it there. Mm-mm. So, Pastor Kash, when you're going through the walkway, I know you're going through stuff, but it's not about you. Oh, Jesus. That doesn't make sense, Louis. How is it not about me and I'm the one feeling the pain? How is it not about me and I'm the one that is broke? Oh, Jesus. How is it about me and I'm the one that is going through this struggle at work? You need to understand that when you are under Jehovah Nissi, is covering her and he covers you. It's not about you. It's about what you have learned from here so you can help here and here and here. Church of God, it's time for us to remain focused. But there's something that the Lord showed me. You see, we don't understand this. Why did the children of Israel complain about everything? Church of God, stop complaining. Hey, I'm not only talking to you, I'm talking to myself. And you need to understand this. Stop complaining. Stop complaining about everything that's happening. Listen to Philippians 4, verse 6, Mama P. Do not worry about anything. It sounds like I'm making up these scriptures, but it's the word of God. Philippians 4 verse 6 says, do not worry about anything. Instead, what? Complain. It says, instead, pray about everything. I love this. Tell God what you need and thank him for what he has already done. Oh, Jesus. Tell him what you need, but thank him for where he has already taken you from. Oh, God. He took you from Egypt. Thank him for that. But tell him that you need bread. Oh, Lord, I wonder if the church is following me. Then you will experience God's peace. Church, it did not say, Penny, that you will experience God's peace and then pray. It says you have to not worry about anything. And then you pray about everything and you have to tell God what you need and you have to thank him and then you will experience the peace of God. Why is it some of us not experiencing the peace? Because we're not praying or thanking God. Church, you need to understand what I'm saying. I'm not saying that things are not hard. Listen, I live hardship. I know things are hard. I know things are difficult. But what I'm saying is most times we blame God because we're looking back. Now follow me. We're looking back at the physically nice things in Egypt. We're looking back at the physically nice things in Egypt. But we didn't remember the slavery. We didn't remember that in Egypt we were being bound by the enemy. We didn't remember that in Egypt he tried to steal from us, to kill us, and to destroy us. Listen to what the Israelites said or did. And unfortunately, this is us most times. Exodus 14, verse 11 to 12. And they said to Moses, where are they now? They're in the wilderness. Where are they going? To the promised land. But listen to what they said in the midst of the wilderness. Why did you bring us here to die in the wilderness? Weren't there enough graves for us in Egypt? What have you done to us? Why did you make us leave Egypt? Didn't we tell you this will happen while we were still in Egypt? We said, leave us alone. Let us be slaves to the Egyptians. It is better to be slave in Egypt than a corpse in the wilderness. Do you know why they made this statement, Tamavi? Because their focus was on the wilderness and not on the promised land. Church of God, where's your focus? If your focus is in the issue, If your focus is in the problem, you will never see the promised land. But listen, that wasn't on it. They were so interested in the physical things and the material things of Egypt. Listen to this. Listen to Exodus 16, verse 3. Please remember, these are the chosen children of God. These are the ones that God chose. Listen to what they said. If only the Lord had killed us back in Egypt, they mourned. There we sat around pots filled with meat and eat all the bread we wanted. Their focus was their belly, the material things. But now you have brought us into the wilderness to starve us all to death. Church, follow me. Numbers, we're going to jump to Numbers 14, 1 to 4. Listen what they said. Then the whole community, this means the whole Israelites, began weeping aloud and they cried all night. Listen what they said. Their voices rose in great chorus of protest against Moses and Aaron. If only we had died in Egypt, or even here in the wilderness, they complain. Why is the Lord taking us to this country only to have us die in battle? Our wives and our little ones were carried off as plunder. Wouldn't it be better for us to return to Egypt? Then they didn't only complain. This is what they started to do now. Then they plotted amongst themselves. Let us get rid of Moses, the one who God has called to lead us, and choose our own leader and go back to Egypt. I'm here to tell someone this morning, stop plotting your own demise. Stop wishing, and you have to listen to me carefully. Stop wishing you had something now that you had back then. Oh, I wish that I had this like I had then. That's idol food. Church, that's idol food. That food was dedicated to Satan. I'm not talking about Israel. I'm talking about us. The life you used to live. Stop wishing that some of the stuff you had then, you have it now. I pray that we'll understand that God, not will, but already has made a way of escape. Church, like the Israelites, you are heading to the land that is full of what? Milk and honey. It's time to walk into your purpose. It's time to walk into your promise. It's time to walk into your destiny. It's time to walk into your giftings. And I could call your name right now, but I'm going to leave you right there. It's time to walk into your giftings. No, follow this. The Bible says your heavenly Father is not slack concerning his promises. The Bible said he's not a man that he can lie. So why are we doubting him? Because we're in the wilderness. We're doubting the God of the wilderness. Because the wilderness, Louis, seems so difficult, we forgot that he's still the God of the wilderness. Because the Bible says the earth is the Lord's and the fullness thereof, the world and they that dwell therein. Therefore, what does that mean? That means everything belongs to God. I'm wrapping this up. I need to wrap this up. Church, Jehovah Nissi, he came to the people. Why? Because they cried out. You know what he did? He remembered his promise of how he will never leave them nor forsake them because they cried out to him. He remembered his promise that he will uphold them in his righteous right hand. Listen to Exodus 3, 7 to 10. I think this is what Amarvi read. The Lord says, I have indeed seen the misery of my people in Egypt. I have heard them crying because of their slave drivers, and I'm concerned about their suffering. So I've come down to do what? Rescue them from the hand of the Egyptians and to bring them out into a land that is good and spacious, flowing with milk and honey. Now, Moses, go. I'm sending you to Pharaoh to bring my people. Listen to the question. Who has the Father sent to help you come out of your struggle? You see, we need to understand that the Father always chooses a man. When I say man, I'm talking man, woman, so please understand me. He always chooses someone to send to you to what? To help you into the promised land. Church, the question is, don't preach my sermon for me. Hallelujah. Are you willing or are you even listening? You see, many times, can you imagine the children of Israel in the wilderness, they behave like they knew everything. They behave like they knew everything. But God says, listen, I sent Moses for you. Because, Jesus. Every time God wanted to talk to the Israelites, he spoke to who? Moses. Now, please don't misunderstand what I'm saying. I am not saying that God is always going to talk to a man to help you. That's not what I'm saying. What I'm saying is there are situations that we go through that in order for you to be delivered from it, you have to go through those who God has sent to help you cross over. That's just it. There's another thing though. Who has God sent you to help? Tara, some of us are so focused on our situation, we don't understand that God has sent us to help somebody else. Because all we can see is our lack of. And not the fact that we serve Jehovah Nissi, who is covering us. Jehovah Jireh. Jehovah Sid Kenyu. Jehovah Makadesh. We don't remember those things. You know why? Because our only focus is our wilderness. Are you obedient, Church of God? And I'm talking to KB Worship Center here now. Are you obedient to go into Wilkes-Barre to spread the word of Jesus? You see, we can say yes, but the question is, have we done it? You know, I met a man yesterday. When we were putting up the banner. And he said, Pastor, I'm tired of going into the building for church. And I said, what? He said, let me explain. People say they are changed, but they're doing the same thing that they used to do before. He says, I've been to so many churches and I start to call it out. And instead of they stand with me, they criticize me. So I'm done with the church. I gave him a track. I said, listen, I'm inviting you. He says, we'll see. So that's okay. We had a conversation yesterday with a group of young men by Louis. And funny enough, they were all unsaved young men. And you know what they started to talk about? The state of the church. How sad it was. How now homosexuals are in charge of the church. That's what these young men are talking about. One of them says, I'll never forget. He says, you know, I see myself as a Christian, and I snickered. I'm like, okay, you've been cursing left, right, and center. But guess what? There are pastors that do the same thing he does. So they can't tell him that he's not a Christian. They can't. We have lost our identity, Church of God. We have lost who we are. So nobody wants to come in because the very way they act on the outside, it happens in the church. What are we teaching our young people? Listen, if you want your young people or your children to walk the way God has them, they will never get it at school. They will never learn that at school. Why? Because now we have taken Bible out of the school. So where do they get it? Sometimes as parents, we ourselves are so messed up. See, we don't like to admit the truth. Because sometimes as parents, we argue in front of our kids. And now our kids are like, if mom and dad say they're a Christian and they behave like that, oh, Jesus. What am I saying? I'm not attacking the church. I'm just tired of what this is. When are we going to make a change? When are we going to start, not like the Israelites look back at Egypt, at the fish that they had in Egypt, at the meat that they had in Egypt, but decide that we're going to walk through the wilderness because guess what? There's milk and honey. When are we going to get to the place where instead of looking back at the fish, we understand that God provides manna every day? You know what I love about that scripture, Katie, is that God said to them, don't leave any for tomorrow. That's what I love about it. You know why? Because he's saying, listen, I have so much, you will never run out. All you have to do is to worry about today. Because tomorrow, oh, there's going to be fresh. It's time we stop focusing on what we had and start to focus on where we're going. When you focus on where you're going, you will never know about the stress that you're having in the middle. Let me share this testimony with you. And now, Mama Paulita wasn't there. Pastor Kashina was. And there's some other persons in Jamaica that they saw this happen to me. I don't remember the year, but it's the speaker that's going to come to Pastor Kashina's conference next year. Margaret, I was standing in the church and I was the pastor of the church in Jamaica. But I was angry with the bishop because he told a lot of lies on me. I was really mad. And she's preaching at this woman's conference and she says, she stops in the middle of preaching. Listen, she's preaching. Everyone in the church is like, yeah, and she stops. And I'm at the back like, hallelujah, yeah, yeah.
She stops. She says, Pastor Edgar, forgive the bishop. I'm like, what's wrong with this lady? So I said to her from the back, I've already forgiven the bishop, woman of God. It's okay. She says, paraphrasing, she says, if you have, go and hug him. I said, I don't need to hug him because I've already forgiven him. She says, then hug him. That's simple. I said, woman of God, I don't need to hug him. She says, Pastor, if you have forgiven him, hug him. And we went back and forth because I'm like, I don't need to hug him. I've already forgiven him. She says, Pastor Edgar, you have not forgiven the bishop. You've told yourself you've forgiven the bishop. You called to him, but you haven't forgiven him. So in front of everyone, I took myself over there and I hugged the bishop. And then I started crying. I just started weeping because I recognized I really didn't forgive the man. I was tolerating the man. Oh, somebody needs to get that. Sometimes we claim we forgive people, but we're really only tolerating them because we have to be in your space. That broke something. It's time to truly forgive. It's time to let it go and let God. And then you know what she did, Kiba? She started to preach again. So I'm like, okay, she's off me now. And Margaret, 5 minutes after she stopped again in her sermon, her husband, at the time, Church of God, was I've lost weight. Her husband, at the time, was maybe twice or maybe almost three size of me now. Plus, he was tall. About 6'4", and bigger than me. So I have to look up at him. Plus, I have to look because he's huge. Thank God they have lost so much weight. It's a miracle how they look now. And then the woman of God says, she says, what's his name again? His name is Cecil. She says, Cecil, I want you to go and Pastor Edgar's back. And I'm like, go on whose back? I don't care if I'm a pastor. There's no man that's going on my back. Because I was very raw, child. God has rubbed me down so much now. I'm like, no man is coming on my back. Plus, look at that guy. He can't hold on my back. Don't miss this church. She says, Pastor Edgar, when are you going to say yes? When are you going to submit? And I'm like, I've submitted already. I've said yes. She says, no, Cecil, go on Pastor Edgar's back. Now, you don't know me back then, but I argued. Church, this is Louis, this is in the middle of a conference. So everybody's looking at me, and I'm like, no man coming on my back. Plus, how big he is. And she said, she walked to me. She said, Pastor, will you just not please submit and say yes? The only thing I don't remember is whether I knelt down or I stood up. I leaned forward and he came on my back. And then she said, so he's on my back. And I'm like, so now there's tears running down my face because I'm like, this doesn't make any sense. What is this? She says, Cecil, lift your foot off the ground. In other words, she's saying, Edgar, it's time to take him fully. Church, I need you to understand what I'm saying. I'm talking about the wilderness. My eyes close and I'm weeping and I'm holding on to him. She says, now walk. Now walk. Now walk. At this point,
I'm not thinking about nothing. Step by step. Step by step. Tears flowing down my face. And then the next thing I hear her say is, okay, Edgar, stop. Open your eyes. Church, you know what? I took him from the back of the church to the front and felt no pain. She said to me, Edgar, how did you do that? I'm like, I don't know. She says, because you weren't focused on the weight. You were focused on the end. All you wanted to hear was that he should come off you. That's the end. How many of us, we're so focused on the trouble. We're so focused on the weight. Oh, it feels too heavy to go another step. But God didn't call us to focus on the weight. He says, cast all your cares on who? On him. Because he cares for you. All he says is, keep your eyes on me. If you keep your eyes on me, you will walk through the wilderness. Of course you'll get bruises. Of course you'll get bruises. Because that's life. Life happens. But at the end, there's a reward for you. Milk and honey. Everyone stand for me, please. The only way I can close this out, I'm going to read a passage of scripture. Now, it's very long, but I need you to listen to it. So this is how I'm closing out, because this is the prior, okay, this passage of scripture. But as you listen, so I'm going to invite you to close your eyes and listen. Ask yourself, is this what I want? Numbers 11 from verse 1. Soon the people began to complain about their hardship, and the Lord heard everything they said. Then the Lord's anger blazed against them, and he sent a fire to rage against them. And he destroyed some of the people in the outskirts of the camp. Then the Lord screamed to Moses for help. Then the people screamed to Moses for help. And when he prayed to the Lord, the fire stopped. After that, the area was known as Tabera, which means the place of burning, because fire from the Lord had burned among them there. Then the foreign rabble who were traveling with the Israelites began to carve the good things of Egypt. And the people of Israel also began to complain. Oh, for some meat, they exclaimed. We remember the fish we used to eat for free in Egypt. And we had all the cucumbers, melons, leeks, onions, and garlic we wanted. But now our appetites are gone. All we ever see is manna. They were complaining about what God was provided. The manna looked like small seeds. It was pale yellow like gum resin. The people would go out and gather it from the ground. They made flour by grinding it with hand mills or pounding in its mortars. Then they boiled in it a pot and made it into flat cakes. These cakes tasted like pastries baked with olive oil. The manna came down on the camp with the dew during the night. Moses heard all the families standing in the doorways of their tents whining, and the Lord became extremely angry. Moses was also very aggravated, and Moses said to the Lord, why are you treating me, your servant, so harshly? Have mercy on me. What did I do to deserve the burden of all these people? Moses said, did I give birth to them? Did I bring them into the world? Why did you tell me to carry them in my arms like a mother carries a nursing baby. How can I carry them to the land you swore to give to their ancestors? Where am I supposed to get meat for all these people? Because they keep whining to me saying, give us meat to eat. I cannot carry all these people by myself, Moses said. The load is far too heavy. If this is how you intend to treat me, just go ahead and kill me. Do me a favor and spare me this misery. Moses, then the Lord said to Moses, gather before me 70 men who can be recognized as elders and leaders of Israel. Bring them to the tabernacle to stand there with me. I will come down and talk to you there. I will take some of the spirit that is upon you, and I'll put the spirit upon them also. They will bear the burden of the people along with you, so you will not have to carry it alone. And say to the people, purify yourself, for tomorrow you will have meat to eat. Church, listen to this. You were whining, and the Lord heard your cry. Oh, for some meat. We were better off in Egypt. Now the Lord will give you meat and you will eat it. But listen, and it won't be just for a day or two or for 5 or 10 or even 20. You will eat it for a whole month until you are gagged and sick of it. For you have rejected the Lord who is here among you, and you have whined to him saying, why did we ever leave Egypt? But Moses responded to the Lord, there are 6,000 foot soldiers here with me. And yet you say, I will give them meat for a whole month. Even if we butchered all our flocks and herds, would that satisfy them? Oh God. Even if we caught all the fish in the sea, would that be enough for them? Then the Lord said to Moses, as my arm lost its power, now you will see whether or not my word comes true. So Moses went out and reported the Lord's words to the people. He gathered the 70 elders and stationed them around the tabernacle. And the Lord came down in the cloud and spoke to Moses. Then he gave the 70 elders the same spirit that was upon Moses. And when the spirit rested upon them, they prophesied. But this never happened again. I'm going to jump to verse 29. But Moses replied, are you jealous for my sake? I wish that all of the Lord's people were prophets and that the Lord will put his spirit upon them. Then Moses returned to the camp with the elders of Israel. Now the Lord sent a wind that brought quail from the sea and let them fall all around the camp. For miles in every direction, there were quail flying about 3 feet above the ground. So the people went out and caught quail all that day and throughout the night and all the next day too. No one gathered less than 50 bushels. They spread the quail all around the camp to dry. But while they were gorging themselves on the meat, while it was still in their mouths, the anger of the Lord blazed against the people, and he struck them down with severe plague. So the place was called Kibroth, which means graves of gluttony, because there they buried the people who had craved meat from Egypt. There they buried the people who had craved meat from Egypt. Why are we craving the things that God says we should leave? He will give it to you, but it will be your own demise. Church, this blew my mind as I read it. Because we complain about what we have today. Because we want what we used to have. When what God provides daily is what is better for us now. Let's stop looking back. Let's go forward. Because forward is a land filled with milk and honey. And yes, we have to go through the wilderness. But Jehovah Nissi is our banner. Father, thank you for your word this morning. Thank you, Almighty God, that your word is sharp and quick, Almighty God. Thank you, Father, that you spoke. I know you spoke to me even as I, Lord, released the word to your people. Father, help me not to look back. Help me not to remember the days when I felt I had it all. But help me to focus on where you're taking me. Help me not to stop in the middle of the wilderness. But Lord, to lift my head to the hills from whence cometh my help, because my help comes from the Lord. Father, we worship you. We adore you. We lift you up. Father, I pray that you'll bring change into this place, in our individual lives. I decree and declare that when we leave here, we will never be the same again. In Jesus' precious name we pray. Amen and amen. Can you put your hands together for the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords? Hallelujah. You may take your seat. You may take your seat. Hallelujah. I want to thank Facebook for joining us. We appreciate you. We continue to pray for you, Facebook. We see the many messages. And as I said, we are praying for you, and we will get back to some of you who we have not gotten back to yet. Be blessed, Facebook. Thank you for joining us. In Jesus' name, amen and amen.